बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। आई एम डॉक्टर मोहम्मद लतीफ़, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर ऑफ मेडिसिन फ्रॉम अख्तर सईद ट्रस्ट हॉस्पिटल। आई वेलकम द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ फोर्थ ईयर MBBS फॉर टूडेज लेक्चर, विच इज लेक्चर नंबर 9, एंड द टॉपिक ऑफ द डे इज हॉजकिंस लिम्फोमा। First of all, the learning objectives. The learning objectives are that after the lecture, you will be able to define the Hodgkin lymphoma. You will be able to describe the clinical manifestations of Hodgkin lymphoma, and you will be able to enlist the classification of Hodgkin lymphoma, and you will also learn the differential diagnosis of Hodgkin lymphoma, and you will always remember the different clinical treatment options of Hodgkin lymphoma and its complications. I mean the treatment of the complications also, in addition to the underlying or non-relapsing disease or uncomplicated disease. And finally, you will be able to distinguish the prognosis of the Hodgkin lymphoma because it is variable and it is dependent upon the manifold risk factors categorization. The lymphomas are malignant tumors of the lymphoid tissues which are characterized by the abnormal proliferation of the B or T lymphocytes in the lymphoid tissue. The definition of Hodgkin lymphoma is that the Hodgkin lymphoma, previously known as Hodgkin disease, is a group of cancers which is characterized by the RS or Reed-Sternberg cells in an appropriate reactive cellular background, which means there are two things. One is there are RS cells or Reed-Sternberg cells, and the background is cellular or reactively cellular. The important clinical feature is that its tendency to arise within the lymph nodes areas, and it spreads in an orderly fashion to the contiguous areas of the lymph nodes. I mean, say for example, from the cervical it may spread to the armpit or axillary region, and from axillary region it may spread to the inguinal region. So this is the word meaning of the word contiguous spread of the lymph nodes, contiguous spread of the disease from lymph node to lymph node contiguously. Epidemiology: incidence is 2.6 cases per 100,000 in United States and 3.8 per 100,000 males in the United Kingdom and 2.8 per 100,000 females. The age, as far as the age of the patient is concerned, as to what is the age at which the disease is likely to present or inflict the patient, it is bimodal, which means that it can present at two age groups of the patient. The first age group is the younger one, in which the patient, usually the age of the patient is less than 20. But predominantly, this kind of the Hodgkin disease is non-sclerosing Hodgkin lymphoma. And the second mode is the one in which almost the senior citizens are affected. Rather, the patients are on the mean greater than 50 years of age, and this type of the Hodgkin lymphoma is mixed cellularity Hodgkin lymphoma. So remember that the senior age group, because it is bimodal, in the senior age groups the type of the Hodgkin disease is mixed cellularity Hodgkin lymphoma, and in the younger age group the type of the lymphoma is non-sclerosing Hodgkin lymphoma. As far as the gender is concerned, incidence is higher in males than females, and 85% of the young boys are victims of Hodgkin lymphoma in the initial peak mode और इनिशियल और अर्ली एज ग्रुप्स. द इटियोलॉजी इज वेरिएबल. कॉमनली द इन्फेक्शंस इंक्लूडिंग एब्स्टीन वास वायरस प्रोटीन्स दे आर 30% रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर द कॉज ऑफ द हॉजकिन डिजीज और लिम्फोमा. एंड यूजली द लिम्फोमा इज क्लासिकल एंड ऑल्सो द मिक्स सेलुलरिटी वराइटी इज ऑल्सो पॉसिबल विद द इन्फेक्शन ऑफ द एब्स्टीन वास वायरस. सिमिलरली द एच आई वी हैज ऑल्सो बीन हेल्ड रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर द कॉज ऑफ द हॉजकिन डिजीज बट इट इज नॉट एन एड डिफाइनिंग न्यूप्लाज्म. Which means that the AIDS can cause Hodgkin disease, but Hodgkin disease cannot cause AIDS. Okay, so as far as the genetics is concerned, 1% of family history, only 1%, very little incidence. It has been calculated and observed after data collection that only 1% they run in the families, and the sibling in the siblings, however. The incidence is 2 to 7 fold increased risk, especially the last one, nodular sclerosing Hodgkin lymphoma. There is 100 fold risk in the identical twins. So if the twins are born to a patient who is suffering from Hodgkin disease, then both the twins, the risk is 100 fold. Okay, so the twins are, in the twins the risk is highest, and in the siblings the risk is the 2 to 7 fold, and otherwise the run in the family is only 1%. Continuing the etiology, it has also got an HLA association and HLA class 2 genotypes, HLA DRB1 and HLA DQB1 is associated with non-sclerosing Hodgkin lymphoma, and there is single nucleotide polymorphism in 6p chromosome 20 and 32 regions rich in the genes, and it leads to the immune dysfunction causing nodular sclerosing Hodgkin lymphoma. The nucleotide polymorphism occurs in the arms of the genes, arms of the chromosomes, which are rich in the genes. So remember always that the short and long arm of the chromosomes may be the sites of the genes in which there is nucleotide polymorphism phenomena going on, which is responsible for the genesis of the disease. The majority of the cases of Hodgkin lymphomas have clonal IgG rearrangement. By the word clonal means that the similar tribes of the cells, they have similar IgG immunoglobulin rearrangement with somatic hypermutation, which means that there is, on one hand, there is humoral rearrangement, the immunoglobulin rearrangement, and there is also hypermutation in the cells. So this is known as somatic hypermutation. Explaining further, it is a cellular mechanism by which the immune system adapts to the new foreign elements that confront it, the microbes. The microbes have been earlier mentioned. Clearly identifying that HR cells are as a neoplastic germinal center derived from the B cells. The Hodgkin Reed server cells are neoplastic germinal center derived B cells. Then coming to the nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma as well is believed to be derived from a B cell as indicated by the clonal VDJ variable diversity joining rearrangements of the immunoglobulin heavy chain locus in the malignant lymphocyte and histiocytic cells, lymphocyte and histiocytic cells. So once again I am explaining that the clonal rearrangement of the immunoglobulins, and in the second cross, which is NLPHL, there is BDJ rearrangement of the immunoglobulin heavy chains. So remember that there is the rearrangement of the immunoglobulins is responsible for the malignant transformation of the varieties of the Hodgkin lymphoma. Histopathological classification, one is unclassified, the second category is classified. The unclassified includes nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma, which means NLPHL. It is unclassified. The classical Hodgkin lymphoma is lymphocyte rich, lymphocyte mixed cellularity, and the nodular sclerosing. So remember, lymphocyte rich, nodular sclerosing, and mixed cellularity, they are known as classical Hodgkin lymphomas, and the lymphocyte predominant are known as unclassified Hodgkin lymphomas as per the classification. And the lymphocyte depletion is also falls under Hodgkin disease. So the majority of the Hodgkin lymphomas are classical one. Only the one type is which is unclassified. It is non-nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma. It is unclassified. Its incidence is poor. Classical Hodgkin lymphoma, this variant comprises about 90% of all the Hodgkin lymphomas and shows typical bipodal age distribution. Each histological subtype is characterized by a series of clinical, morphological, phenotypic and genotypic features. I mean the nodular sclerosis, mixed cellularity, lymphocyte depletion, and the lymphocyte-rich Hodgkin lymphoma. These are the classical Hodgkin lymphoma types, and their features are variable: morphological, phenotypic, and genotypic. In classical Hodgkin lymphoma, classical Reed Schirmer cells can be easily detected. Okay, so the one thing to be remembered with more stress is that if you find Reed RS cells or Reed Schirmer cells, there are more chances that the patient is suffering from classical Hodgkin lymphoma or CHL. The diagnostic Reed RS cells are large cells in diameter. The nucleus is bilobed or polylobed. It may be mononuclear, I mean the no lobes. The RS cells are B cells. There are no antibodies. The T cell origin RS cells, they have markers CD30, CD50 antigen, and CD30 lymphocyte. CD30 marker, they lead to lymphocyte activation, and CD50 marker lead to activation of the granulocyte, monocytes, and activated C cells. So you see the picture, the Reed Schirmer cells of the Hodgkin lymphoma, they have classical owl-eye appearance. When you find this picture, it may be placed in the OSPI if there is the cells are having the shape of the eyes of the owl. You should straightway commit that these are the RS cells, and the diagnosis is Hodgkin lymphoma. Now coming to the nodular sclerosing Hodgkin lymphoma, it constitutes 6 to 8% of all cases of Hodgkin lymphoma. The morphological nodular pattern and the fibrosis, two features are the as its name is indicative, there is sclerosis, which means there is fibrosis, and nodularity, dividing the node into the nodules. I mean the same single node, it is dividing into the nodules. Then the lacunar type RS cells they have a small nucleolus and abundant cytoplasm. They usually involve the mediastinum of the chest. So on X-ray chest, if you find that there are lymph nodes and you suspect Hodgkin lymphoma, then that Hodgkin lymphoma will be containing the lacunar type of the Diels-Turner cells, and it is common in the younger people. Then the mixed cellularity Hodgkin lymphoma, it constitutes about 15-30% of the cases. The infiltrate is diffuse. So instead of the lymph nodes, there may be an infiltrate in the chest, but they may have classical Diels-Turner cells. They affect abdominal lymph nodes and the spleen. So remember, in addition to the chest, the lymph nodes in the abdomen and hepatopogaly, splenomegaly, hepatosplenomegaly may also occur, and in mixed cellularity, the classical Diels-Turner cells may be found in the spleen, but there, instead of the nodule formation or lymph node presence, there may be an infiltrate which may be diffuse in these areas, especially in the abdomen and the spleen. And they present as advanced stage disease with systemic symptoms. So remember that if the patient of lymphoma presents with the advanced feature, the diagnosis is likely to be mixed cellularity type of the classical Hodgkin lymphoma, and it has a common association with the HIV patients. Then the lymphocyte depleted Hodgkin lymphoma, it constitutes only 1% of the cases. Infiltrate is hypocellular, large number of the RS cells and bizarre sarcomatous variants may also be found. They are associated with the older age groups, and the HIV may also be implicated in these patients. They also present as advanced age disease, and the Epstein-Barr virus proteins are found on many of these tumors. So remember that the lymphocyte depleted can have an association or underlying cause as Epstein-Barr virus and association with the HIV, and they also present as infiltrates, and they have Diels-Turner cells, but their incidence is very poor, only 1% of all cases of the Hodgkin lymphoma. Then the lymphocyte rich Hodgkin lymphoma, it constitutes 5% of the cases overall, and the Diels-Turner cells of the classical or lacunar type are found, so it is a mixture of the previous ones, and they require immunohistochemical diagnosis. Then the nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma, it constitutes 5% of the cases, and it is a distinct clinical entity, not considered classical Hodgkin lymphoma. Rather, it is unclassified Hodgkin lymphoma. Lymphocytes and histiocytic cells or popcorn cells are found in a background of benign lymphocytes. So the background is rich with the lymphocytes, and there may be classical lymphocytes and histiocytic cells which may be of the shape of popcorn cells. So if some comment is given by the histopathologist that there are popcorn cells, then the diagnosis is obvious, which is nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma. The lymphocyte and histiocytic cells are positive for B cell antigens, and the marker CD20 are there, but they are negative for CD15 and CD30. So only CD20 marker will be positive in nodular lymphocyte predominant Hodgkin lymphoma, but marker CD15 and CD30 will be absent. It is diagnosed by the immunohistochemical studies. Clinical features of the Hodgkin lymphoma include: the patient may present to with the asymptomatic lymphadenopathy. Usually the lymph nodes of the Hodgkin disease or Hodgkin lymphoma, they may be found in the groups, but they are in the, say, cervical region, axillary region, abdomen or inguinal region, but their lymph nodes have special features which are that the they are discrete rubbery lymph nodes. By discrete, I mean they are not, though they are lying like close to each other, but they identify their position. They don't join hands with each other. They don't become united with each other. So that is why they are known. They are called as discrete and rubbery. When you palpate the lymph nodes of Hodgkin's disease, the feeling will be as you are pressing a rubber. So rubbery feeling or palpation will be a feature of the Hodgkin's disease lymph nodes. Then the patients have B symptoms. By B symptoms I mean that the patient has fever, which is unexplained. You may call it as PGO, and the patient has weight loss, which is more than 10% in the 6 months. And the patient has also drenching night sweats. These are known as classical B symptoms, and they may are a special feature of the Hodgkin lymphoma. As far as the fever is concerned, the fever of the Hodgkin disease is usually Pell-Epstein fever, which means that the patient will complain to you, "Well, doctor, I get fever, say after 2 weeks, say after three weeks, but when I get it, the fever is very high grade and there is profuse sweating. The sweating is so much that it wets my clothing." So that is why it is known as drenching night sweats. So the patient has Pell-Epstein type of the fever, intermittent, which is fortnightly or 3 weekly or monthly. And it has a special feature, special role towards the prognosis and staging of the disease if the B symptoms are present. Then the patient can also have chest pain, cough and shortness of breath, especially if the mediastinal lymph nodes are involved, and the patient does have pruritus, and there is pain at the site of the nodal disease, especially if the patient is an alcohol user. The patient may have bony pain or back pain if the bone marrow is also involved, or bones are involved. Then, signs of the Hodgkin lymphoma. Said earlier, the patient may have asymptomatic lymphadenopathy, which may be palpable in the cervical, axillary, and inguinal area. Then the Velde ring may be involved, which includes the areas back of the throat, including the tonsils, and the occipital part of the head, lower area of the head, and epitrochlear region inside the upper arm near the elbow. When these areas are involved, we call it as a Velde ring involvement. Then the patient can have SVC obstruction and producing these superior vena cava obstruction because of the mediastinal lymph nodes. Then in the CNS, the patient may have paraneuroplastic syndrome, cerebellar degeneration. So if somebody finds a patient who has cerebellar features, do think a cause, Hodgkin lymphoma as a cause of cerebellar syndrome. Usually the degenerative or hypothyroidism or alcohol are held responsible for the cerebellar degeneration or cerebellar disease or syndrome. But mind you that the Hodgkin lymphoma is also a culprit which can cause cerebellar syndrome. The patient can have neuropathy, the patient can have Guillain-Barré syndrome or GB syndrome, and the patient can have also multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Other features include cachexia, anemia, splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, and rarely the patient may have jaundice because of the there are infiltrative lesions in the liver, and if there is also hemolysis ongoing. Then the special feature about the Hodgkin disease is that if the patient of Hodgkin disease is offered alcohol, the patient can get pain. And the patient with Hodgkin lymphoma complains of severe pain following alcohol injection. Severe pain. This pain is severe. Then, when you investigate the patient, you do the CBC, you may find anemia, lymphomania, neutrophilia, eosinophilia, high ESR, usually greater than 100, and the patient may have hypercalcemia, hypernatremia, and LDH may be high, glucose may be low because of the insulin autoantibodies. The patient may have high serum creatinine because of the kidney involvement leading to the nephrotic syndrome, and the patient may have high ALP because of the liver and bone involvement, and hypercalcemia, hypernatremia, hypoglycemia are features other described already. Then the patient may be HIV positive, HBV positive, HCV positive. For that you will have to offer the antiviral therapy and antiretroviral therapy, and it does improve the outcome in cases of the Hodgkin lymphoma if they are coexisting or if they are the underlying factors in the causation of the Hodgkin lymphoma. So you have to offer anti-HCV viral therapy, anti-B viral therapy and anti-retroviral therapy for the AIDS, and the there is a greater benefit to the Hodgkin lymphoma, rather it may be may go into the remission. Then the cytokines you have to check, especially the interleukin-6, interleukin-10 and the marker CD25 should also be checked in the investigations. Imaging studies, X-ray chest, you check the mediastinal masses, CT chest, and you check the abdomen and pelvis for lymph nodes, splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, lung nodules or infiltrates, I have already told. Sometimes the pleural effusion may also be a feature, which is very rarely found. And then the PET scan for staging of the disease, it detects the bone disease involvement, and it also detects the extramedullary sites of the multiple myeloma and Hodgkin disease with high sensitivity and high specificity. It is benefit of the PET scanning is that you can monitor the treatment response and you can predict the prognosis to the patient. So this is the benefit of the PET scanning. In addition to the staging, you have other benefits which I have already mentioned. Do the FNAC of the lymph nodes, and you can do the FNAC in any area around the head and neck cancer. Then the axial biopsy, if the FNAC is of no yield or poor yield or not diagnostic, then go for the axial biopsy, and you can rule out the squamous cell carcinoma also. Then you do the bone marrow examination for biopsy for elderly people or advanced disease where it is a high risk histology. So do go for the bone marrow examination in cases of the Hodgkin lymphoma, especially in the elderly people. Then you can do the LP for CNS involvement and MRI brain for the brain involvement. Classification or staging. Stage 1 is a single lymph node, single extranodal site. Stage 2, 2 or more lymph nodes, same side of the diaphragm. Stage 3, lymph node or the bone, both sides of the diaphragm. And stage 4, disseminated extranodal organ involvement. Then the differential diagnosis, the cytomegalovirus is a common differential of the Hodgkin disease. It is a multi-organ infection. The patient does have respiratory involvement. There is a damage to the CNS. The patient can have peptic ulcer, and the patient can have CMV retinitis. Though it is common, very common in the AIDS, but it also falls in the differential diagnosis of the Hodgkin lymphoma because of its involvement of the multisystem. Then the EB virus, infectious mononucleus, is also a strong contender of the differential diagnosis of Hodgkin lymphoma. It is also known as glandular fever. The patient has rash over the body, patient can have tonsillitis, pharyngitis, patient can have peripheral lymphadenopathy, especially the cervical region, axillary region and the inguinal region. So it almost it almost mimics the Hodgkin disease. Then the, of course, the non-Hodgkin lymphoma is a very strong differential of the Hodgkin disease or lymphoma. Sarcoidosis is also a strong differential. It is a disease of unknown etiology with protean clinical manifestation, which means that its clinical presentations are of different types or varieties. Sometimes the eye is involved, sometimes the lung is involved, sometimes the heart is involved, and in addition, the patient does have lymphadenopathy. So because of the presence of the lymphadenopathy, it is a differential, but otherwise is a cheating disease. It presents with protean clinical manifestation. Then the serum sickness is also a differential diagnosis, in which the patient have, in the serum sickness, the patient have immune complexes. Because of the immune complexes, the patient does has fever, rash, and painful joints. And the rash is like hives or wet wellets. The rash is like hives or wellets, which are actually raised itchy lesions. And in addition, the patient has soft tissue swellings. So the, because of the presence of the hives and the presence of the wellets and the presence of the soft tissue swellings, we consider the serum sickness as a differential diagnosis of the Hodgkin lymphoma. Small cell lung cancer, very obvious. There will be either a solid lesion in the lung, or there may be an infiltrative lesion in the lung. So it is a strong differential. And in the lymphoma, there is BHL, popularly known as bilateral hilar lymphadenopathy, or BHL, which is a diagnosis of the Hodgkin lymphoma of the pulmonary involvement type. So BHL can also be found in the sarcoidosis. So this is also a BHL. It is, in that respect, BHL reference, the sarcoidosis and lymphoma, they are close contenders. Then in the secondary stage of the syphilis, it can present with hepatosplenomegaly and lymphadenopathy. Then the toxoplasmosis, which is a parasitic infection, the patient can have lymph node involvement in the neck, and the patient can have lung infiltrates, and the patient can have myocarditis and retinitis. And finally, the tuberculosis, you know, the TB can be of various type. It can involve the lungs. The patient can present with the TB lymph nodes. So that is why it is a very easy differential diagnosis of the Hodgkin and not non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Then the treatment, the radiation therapy is to usually start with the radiation therapy. The first category is involve field radiation. I mean, you radiate only the field which is having the disease. Then the involved site radiation, in the radiate the site which is involved. Then the involved node radiation, you radiate the node only. The abbreviatory or acronym words are written in front of each of these. Then you do the chemotherapy. ABVD regime is very popularly known regime. Adriamycin, bleomycin, vinblastine, dacarbazine. It is used for the induction phase or reduction, used as an induction therapy. And then the BCOP regime, bleomycin, etoposide, doxorubicin, cyclophosphamide, vincristine, and procarbazine, and prednisone. And if you offer this regime, consolidation is not needed, but toxicity is greater with the BCOP regime. Now, selection of the treatment is stage dependent. If the patient is in the stage 1 and 2, which is low risk, the combination of the chemotherapy with INRT or full chemotherapy. Stage 3 or 4 is known as high risk group, and you treat like stage 2 plus, the patient has stage 2 plus large mediastinal and bulky involvement, and the treatment offered is ABVD regime. 6 cycles are given, but there is a risk of pulmonary fibrosis. To avoid the pulmonary fibrosis, you have to treat this high risk disease aggressively in a minimum period of time so that the pulmonary fibrosis does not develop. Then, meanwhile, you do the interim PET scanning, CT scanning to check the fibrosis in the lungs. Then the abnormal interim scanning will mean that it requires an intensive treatment and to complete for complete response. Okay, if the interim scan is found to be abnormal, then you should be further aggressive. You do it more intensively to complete for the completion of the response. In relapse cases, the high dose chemotherapy is offered, then the autologous hematopoietic stem cell transplantation is done. The cure rate is 50%. After hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, then you offer the antibody drug conjugate which is available with the name of brentuximab. Response rate is 75% and cure rate is only 34%. Brentuximab failure, if there is, then you alternative availability drug is nivolumab or pembrolizumab. Then finally, if all the measures fail, then you have to go to the salvage chemotherapy. When induction fail or relapse occur, already told, then you have to go for the salvage regime, and you incorporate drug complementary to the induction therapy. I mean, in addition to the induction therapy, you do the salvage therapy. Salvage regime include ISE, which means I-phosphamide, carboplatin, etoposide, DHAP, cisplatin, cytarabine and prednisolone, and ECHAP, which includes etoposide, methylprednisolone, cytarabine or cisplatin. And then what does the salvage do? Salvage ablates the bone marrow for hematopoietic transplantation. So first do the salvage therapy. It should follow the autologous hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. The toxicity of the treatment is hematological toxicity. Toxicity include the patient can have pancytopenia, the patient can transform into myelodysplasia, mind you, and it can also transform into acute leukemias. So these are the risks of the treatment of the Hodgkin lymphoma. The pulmonary toxicity includes if bleomycin or radiation is given, the patient can develop lung malignancy or cancer, and fibrosis is very much a common feature. Then cardiac toxicity, especially with the anthracycline, and it causes CCF and coronary artery disease. The infections which can accrue especially post-splenectomy, and it is because of the immunodeficiency from the drugs. So when you are offering the chemotherapy, the patient develops immunodeficiency, and if already because of the lymph node involvement, the spleen involvement, the splenectomy has been performed, then there are chances of opportunistic infections to the patients. And the further, in addition to the myelodysplasia and acute leukemia, other cancers can also occur into the patient, especially the breast cancer, because if you are offering the mediastinal radiation, unfortunately the victim is female, the lady can develop the breast cancer. Then the sarcoma and the radiation field if the bone is involved, radiation is done near the bone. Then the neurological toxicity includes neuropathy and muscular atrophy. Then the psychiatric features which the patient can develop, they include depression, anxiety as complications of the treatment. The prognosis, it is risk factor dependent. The staging is done. Risk factors include stage of the disease, age of the disease, gender, hemoglobin level, albumin level, WBC count and lymphocyte count. The cure rate is 75% if there are 0 to 2 risk features. The risk features are already mentioned above: stage, age, gender, etc. यदि क्योर रेट इज 55% इफ थ्री और मोर रिस्क फीचर्स आर प्रेजेंट। प्रोग्नोसिस एक्सीलेंट इन स्टेज 1A to 2A एंड सर्वाइवल रेट इज 10 ईयर्स 90%। 10 ईयर सर्वाइवल रेट इज 90% इफ द स्टेज इज अप टू द लेवल ऑफ 2A। द प्रोग्नोसिस इज पुअर इफ द पेशेंट इज ओल्ड एज और एल्डरली एंड द डिजीज इज बल्की एंड स्पेशली द वराइटीज विच आर हैव पुअर प्रोग्नोसिस दे आर लिम्फोसाइट डिप्लीटेड केसेज एंड मिक्स सेलुलरिटी लीजन। सो रिमेंबर द वर्स्ट प्रोग्नोसिस इज फॉर द लिम्फोसाइट डिप्लीशन वराइटी ऑफ द हॉजकिन लिम्फोमा एंड द मिक्स सेलुलरिटी टाइप ऑफ द हॉजकिन लिम्फोमा। इन द नॉन क्लासिकल हॉजकिन लिम्फोमा हाईली क्योरेबल विद रेडियोथेरापी फॉर अर्ली स्टेज डिजीज हाई स्टेज डिजीज लॉन्ग सर्वाइवर रिलैप्स इज देयर आफ्टर कीमोथेरापी। सो रिमेंबर इट इज हाईली क्योरेबल बट देयर आर स्टिल चांसेस ऑफ रिलैप्स। फिजिकल साइन यू सी द पोस्टीरियर ऑरिकुलर lymph nodes, if you find a similar lymph node in anybody you should suspect Hodgkin lymphoma or non-Hodgkin lymphoma. See cervical lymph node, huge involvement in the patient, submandibular area, anterior and posterior cervical chains of the lymph nodes are involved, and then you see again in the cervical region cervical lymph nodes, and so the how they spread from the cervical to axilla and to the inguinal region in the Hodgkin disease. Then the cutaneous infiltration, if such lesions are found, these are the lesions which make us consider the serum sickness and the CMV, especially the serum sickness, because there are hives and vellets and soft tissue swellings. These lesions of the Hodgkin lymphoma, they force us to consider the serum sickness as a differential diagnosis in the Hodgkin lymphoma. So these are the lymph nodes on X-ray chest and on the CT of the chest. Any question, if you want to ask, you can ask me. Now there are assignment question number 1, question number 2, question number 3, and thank you for joining me today at Akhtar Seth Trust Hospital. The take home message is that you should have a passion for the reading and keep on reading and keep on adding your passions to this basket. So remember the lectures so far I have delivered to you. If you take one paper with a handle, one lecture with a handle, then you must have a collection of a couple of lectures, but the message is you should have a passion for the readings. The more you do the effort, more you learn, and more you learn, more you become knowledgeable, and more you become knowledgeable, and you are a better doctor. This is my take home message, that develop a passion for the reading. The other dictum I can quote is, genius is 99% perspiration. Genius is 99% perspiration. And by perspiration I mean that please work hard. Work hard. Work hard and work hard. Goodbye from Akhtar Seth Trust Hospital.